because I found out last week through purple papers. What that means is City Hall puts confidential information on purple papers, and as a councillor, I can't go public until I'm given permission to go public. So at noon on Friday, I was allowed to go public that in the 2013 budget, my fire station on Runnymede is being closed. That will affect the response time of a fire truck getting to a home in my ward. I think that's not long enough notice. I think it's despicable. My residents should have been pre-warned about this before 48 hours when I am now arranging an emergency meeting for them to come and bring them up to speed on what's happening in this new budget.
What are you hearing from, what are you hearing from your residents about how they're feeling, about how this is all happening?
Well, they're frustrated, they're furious. On Monday and Tuesday of this week, the city is hosting residents coming to do deputations about the budget. My residents found out Friday at noon that they're losing a fire station. Deputations are on Monday and Tuesday at City Hall. They need a chance to get ready to go and do a deputation. Why are we not being transparent? Why are we not informing residents in advance that they are losing a life-saving service? When the mayor came in, he said, no service cuts. Well, I'm sorry, this isn't a matter of how many days between cutting grass. This is someone's life and death. The fire department saved properties from burning. A property is normally the biggest investment anyone in the city makes in their life. But they don't just put out fires, they go for medical emergencies as well. Normally, our fire trucks are the first one on a medical emergency scene. The ambulance comes as quickly as they can. We're short ambulance, we're short EMS. This is going to put my residents' lives at risk, and I think that's despicable. As I say, I'm almost speechless, which is very unusual for me. But we were able to arrange this emergency meeting. We're very fortunate the fire chief has joined us today to explain to residents that because this administration told him to come up with a zero budget increase, this is the kind of thing he has to do. They haven't done it by choice. They've done it because this administration has told them this is what they have to do.
What are you hearing from your residents?
My residents are frustrated that I've only given them 48 hours notice. We managed to get it in some of the local newspapers. We managed to do it through Facebook, email, as much as we can. But as I say, depending for where the fire truck comes, which station the fire truck comes from, depends how quickly it gets to a property or to an emergency. You take one of those trucks out of that equation, it's obviously going to take longer. That's on first response. What happens if we need second or third response? What happens if, for instance, our Swansea fire truck is out, Runnymede no longer exists? Where's the truck going to come to go to the south part of the ward down by the lake? They're not getting there in those 4 minutes, 52 seconds, believe me. I can't get there that fast. They definitely aren't doing that. Therefore, I feel that my residents aren't being protected the way they should be by the city.
Where do you go from here? I mean, you're having this meeting tonight, sorry, but that, where do you go from here?
Where we go from here is let residents have a say. The budget speech, deputations Monday and Tuesday, their cutoff to register was Friday at 4 p.m. I have made an arrangement with the budget chief that anyone from my ward who'd like to come and speak on this topic, he will allow them to do so. So I'm going to be informing residents at the end of at the beginning of the meeting, but if they want to give me their names at the end, I will get them on that deputation list. We're going to be doing petitions. If you can't come and do a deputation, I'm encouraging residents to write letters. Every councillor, all 44 councillors, need to know what this new budget is going to do to this ward.
Thank you so much. Do you have any more questions?
Do you think this is inevitable? Is this going to happen, or do you have a chance of making this fire station, stay alive?
Well, residents who know me, who voted for me, and even those who didn't vote for me, know I don't give up. Before I became a councillor, we did a lot of good in this ward. As a councillor, we've saved a lot of things so far, and I plan to save this station.
Thank you.
So, first of all, my name is Sarah Doucette. I am the city councillor for Ward 13. And I want to thank you all for coming out at such short notice. Thank goodness we have media, amazing media, with our newspapers, our televisions, Facebook, Twitter, you name it. About 1 o'clock on Friday, my staff in my office were pushing buttons to get the information out to everyone. So, I found out about this on what we call purple paper. Purple paper at City Hall is confidential information. I found out on Tuesday that the Runnymede Fire Station is slated to close in the 2013 budget. But I couldn't do anything. Well, I couldn't say anything. I could do things, but I couldn't say things. So straight away, my staff and my office went into action to have this room and to invite the fire chief to come and join us today. So I want to thank my staff because, yeah, not being able to tell people why you're holding a meeting is interesting, to say the least. So as you may know, this administration has told all departments they have to come in with a zero budget increase. So that means it doesn't matter what wages are going up, it doesn't matter the price of gas, utilities, running a fire station, it doesn't matter. You have to come in with a zero increase. Zero increases means you have to do cuts. What frustrates me more than anything is when our mayor came in, he said no service cuts. Now, I kind of call this a service cut. This isn't how many days between cutting grass down on the playing field. This is playing with people's lives. So this is why I called the meeting. I wanted you to understand what is going on. I just want to outline a little bit what you as residents can do. You may know that on Monday and Tuesday of this week, down at City Hall, we're doing budget deputations. We're allowing residents to come and give us your opinion on the 2013 budget. But the deadline was Friday at 4 p.m. Don't worry, the budget chief has agreed if anyone at the end of this meeting would like to come and do a deputation, he and I will add you to the list. I refuse to allow my residents to be not given the opportunity to come and speak at City Hall. If you can't come and speak, which will probably be Tuesday at this because of the number of people who are already registered, we have petitions at the back, which we'll hand out to you after the meeting. Make copies. Get as many petitions signed as you can. That I can take to the January special council meeting where we're looking at budgets. If you can't come, send emails. I've already received copies from residents who've sent emails. In that email, again, there's an information sheet we'll give to you at the end, telling you where to send the email to, indicating you'd like the mayor to see this and all 44 councillors, not just the budget committee. So there are things we can do. It's not too late. I would never let it be too late. Let me just make sure I've told you all the things we need to know. So before I introduce the budget chief, I would like to thank Peggy Nash, our MP, for joining us this afternoon, again, at short notice. We also have Sherry DeNova, our MPP. And I'll tell you, these ladies' schedules are almost as, well, probably more busy than mine because they have two wards to cover. We've just come from an event. And they have rearranged their schedule so they can be here today with us because this is important. So what I'd like to do now, please, what we're going to do for this meeting is I'll introduce the fire chief. He and his deputy are going to do a presentation explaining why they had to come up with this decision. And then we will open the floor for questions and answers. Now, I know this is a passionate topic. And all the meetings I have hosted in the last 2 years, we've all been very respectful. One person speaks at a time, and everyone will be given a chance to ask a question. So let me introduce you, please, to Mr. Jim Sales, our new fire chief.
Thank you all for coming. I'd like to introduce Mr. Michael McCoy. Mike is our deputy of operations. Mike's responsibility is running the day-to-day operations. In other words, the 82 crews or stations and 128 crews in the field. And he's got 30 years in the city of Toronto, so he's got the knowledge and experience about the actual day-to-day operations historically. As your councillor said, this is a difficult time. and a difficult challenge before the fire service. When we look at a zero increase for the fire service, 92.7% of our budget is salaries, direct and indirect. Our business is about a lot of people out there running four shifts, 7 days a week, 24 hours a day. So it's a very busy service. It's the biggest service in Canada. When we look at the numbers, we run more calls per firefighter per station than our peers. We run a very effective service. But all that being said, it is a challenging budget year and a challenging task that faces us getting to a zero. Within my management structure, we've looked at every option. We've looked at reducing our fleet purchase this year by $1 million as far as our gross number. We're fortunate with the strength of the Canadian dollar and the downturn of the American economy. We are able to buy fire trucks at a better price point, and we're doing quite well. We're looking at every single area to reduce the budget. But 12.7 million or 3.6% is a daunting task. We've looked at the exempt areas. We're reducing three exempt positions. We've looked at the service areas within training and other services and also making some reductions. But unfortunately, to get to the target, we have to look at five stations, one being closed and four would lose their second truck and go down to a singular truck. This city's had a practice of something called gapping. When positions weren't filled, they just removed trucks from service, and every day, different trucks would be taken out, and it was a random process. That's gone on for a number of years. What we're proposing and looking at this year is making some decisions in regards to which stations are going to continue operating with complement and which station may need to close. We looked at call volumes. We looked at volumes in all stations. We looked at historic response times. That's the time it takes for a truck to respond from his own area to his geographic service district. Thirdly, we looked at the ability for nearby stations covering those calls if a truck and or station was closed. Runnymede was chosen because it has a smaller geographic service area. When we look at, it has three stations, one within 1.5 kilometers, two others within 2 kilometers. When we look at the response time, it has by far the best response time in the city by almost 45 seconds in its geographic service area. So when we do the math, it is the best opportunity. It's the best choice we can make with the challenge before us. And that's the reason and the only reason it was chosen. We looked at four other stations in the city based on call volumes, the ability to cover, and run times of reducing. That's how we got to our target. We proposed this to our budget committee. The budget committee will get a lot of public deputations. There'll be a lot of discussion and review. And ultimately, City Council will make a decision about mid-January as far as the 2013 budget. When we look at last year we averaged 5.5 trucks out of service every day due to what's called gapping, or the open positions that we had. This year, we're proposing to reduce 5 crews versus the 5.5 last year. There still will be times, if we're short-staffed, we may have to go below that number. So we're proposing 123 units versus 128. But our goal is to find ways to keep those trucks and that many firefighters on the street. And that is a challenge. And that's what we're faced with.
You said four shifts. I thought there was only two. Don't they work 12-hour shifts?
Firefighters in the city of Toronto a number of years ago went to a 24-hour shift. Previously they worked 10s and 14s, but even at 10s and 14s, when you look at the need to cover 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, it takes four full shifts to do that.
Four shifts of workers.
So it's four shifts of workers.
Yes.
Yeah, you talked about trucks going out of service, and my question is, has there been any impact? Have there been people in Toronto who have lost their lives in fires, and were they
in areas where trucks were out of service. I'm just wondering if there's a link with outcomes from fire services when cuts take place.
Unfortunately, there have been some lost lives, but when we look at the injuries, the fatalities, we look at the dollar loss in fires, the number of fires and calls, whether they're medical calls, fire calls, rescue calls, a different type of calls, a busy service like Toronto responds to, typically we have 189,000 responses a year. So it's a very busy department. And when we look at the random taking out of trucks, because the trucks taken out were never the first truck in a station, we typically would still get the first truck on scene in the same historic time. But when you take an additional truck out, it may impact a second, third, fourth, or in some cases we send seven units to what's called the first alarm. And then when we have a second alarm, another seven trucks, and if we build on that number, that's where the missing trucks have an impact. But when you do a rotational removal, it's hard to demonstrate which of those may have had a marginal or major impact at all.
Because there is increased risk with less trucks, and insurance companies typically base their premiums on the amount of risk that they're exposed to, will there be higher fire insurance premiums for homeowners and business owners in the City of Toronto after you take the trucks out of service?
Insurance companies have hired a group that do the insurance rating, and it's called a FUS, F-U-S, a Fire Underwriters Survey. They've been working on the survey since spring, and it's not completed. I actually met with the vice president and the manager doing the survey last week. Fire underwriter surveys have two components. One is the residential. Residential risk is rated on an index 1 to 5. Commercial is rated on an index of 1 to 10. And so they'll be looking at the proposed changes. They'll be looking at what we're proposing and coming back to us with a report to demonstrate to us if there will be an impact on insurance rates. We've also asked them to quantify that in value. What would the financial impact then be to the citizens of Toronto and or the business community?
Do you have a preliminary report from them?
We have a draft, but it's not finalized enough that we could make an assumption or any type of a judgment at this point.
Aside from specific amounts, is there a trend? Will the rates increase? I know that you don't have specifics yet, but will the rates increase?
My opinion would be it's close. I think we're close to the line whether it is impacted or not. They're running the math, and we'll find out. On the meeting last Thursday, they thought they could have it within 2 weeks.
Thank you.
So our goal would be to have that data that we could give to our council before they make their deliberation and decisions mid-January.
Thank you.
I just found out that EMS stations in this riding are also slated to close, and I know that there are provincial dollars behind those as well as city dollars. In your instance, what role can the province play or is playing in this potential cutback?
Well, I think in today's emergency service world, the province of Ontario supports EMS services typically by 50% of the operational cost. In the case of fire department, it's 100% by the municipalities. There isn't or hasn't been to this point in time a contribution by other levels of government.
Okay, cost-benefit analysis. What are you reportedly saving by closing the station down? But I don't know what the value is on human life. And secondly, what stations, particularly in the south end of Swansea, where you're putting in thousands of people in high-rise condominiums, very dense things, are going to be servicing them because they're at the furthest way from your stations towards the north. And I hope to God you're not going to say it's going to be the station in South Etobicoke, because anybody on the Queensway knows there's times when you cannot move on that highway. It's jammed. It's like happens on the Gardiner. So can you let me know the price that you're quote saving and what stations are going to protect the people that you're jamming into the south end of Swansea?
I'll answer your question as it relates to the cost. The cost to operate a station is $1.89 million a year. So that's the cost per station. And that's typically almost 96% of that would be staff cost, and we have some associated facility cost. Mike, do you want to answer the other question in regards to coverage?
Well, the coverage for this specific area would be picked up by the surrounding stations. The one on, well, 425 around the corner would be one. Mm-hmm. 422 over at Jane and Dundas would be the other. And over at Annette Gill Street would be the third. So the, those are the three stations that surround the specific area that we're looking at with Runnymede Station.
But that's an awful long way to get to the south end of Swansea. You quadrupled the population of the south end of Swansea in very high-rise buildings. And my concern is, because I remember in 67, Swansea bought a special fire truck so they could service the condominiums, the south end of Swansea. The first thing you guys did when it was amalgamated was move the truck into the High Park area because you didn't have a truck to service the apartment buildings we were building in High Park. My concern right now is you've got a gap. And I really don't understand. They're the furthest part away, and the stations you're describing are further north of the station, other than Swansea. The other ones you're describing are further north, further east, further west, and you can't get there because you've got Humber River on one side, you got High Park and Red River Pond on the other. The south end of Swansea is basically landlocked, and you're telling me you're moving one of the closest stations away. That doesn't make sense. You've increased the population, you're increasing the population. I don't understand the logic. I understand it's only a few seconds, but I understand a few seconds of the fire is significant.
These aren't easy decisions, sir, and I understand your concerns. It is a challenge. When we look at amount of calls, we've got stations downtown that run, one truck runs over 5,000 calls. Here are these trucks that were considered taking out, two of them run in the neighborhood of 800 calls, and one 13 and one 1500. So there is the ability and the capacity for additional call volume. But that being said, it is still an absolute challenge.
There's no disagreement. It's traveling distance that counts.
Right now, we look at average response times. Response times are made out of three components. The time it takes to dispatch when we receive the call from 911 to analyze the call. The second part is called turnout, the time it takes the fire staff to receive the message in a station, gather the data, and leave the station. And the third is driving distance, or what we call response time. We're challenged with all three. Run times in the city now on 82 stations, our goal is under 4 minutes. And throughout the entire city, we're over 4 minutes. There are areas it is difficult. There are certain times, if I looked at average times, we do excellent. But we try to meet what's called the 90% criteria. And that is a challenge because of rush hours and busy periods. Average times are excellent. If we look at our total goal, 6 minutes and 20 seconds, our average is 5 minutes and 15 seconds. But to the 90 percentile, we're about 7 minutes and 20 seconds.
I think one of our concerns, and I just want to continue what Bill was saying, is we have new development coming into our ward. We got two buildings right now at Jane and Bloor. We have a new development possibly down at Southport, which is everything south of here. There's another two developments on Bloor Street, and I've got developers walking in my office every week, no, nearly every week, wanting to do more towers down south. So I think the concern is Swansea has one truck, which is right behind us here. If that one is out and we have a high-rise fire, we're looking at Jane and Dundas or Keel and Dundas to get to our landlocked south end. That's a concern. As we were talking earlier, high-rises, you get to the front door, but then you've got to get up all those stairs, and that could keep that truck busy a lot longer than if it was doing a single-family home.
One of the challenges... Today's fire service is really built on a model. The model was built on something called NFPA, National Fire Protection Association Standard 1710. 1710 standard is for single family detached homes. Was built on homes of 2,000 square feet or less, two floors, no basements. That's how the standard was built. It was originally 6 minutes, and then was modified to 6 minutes and 20 seconds. The goal is, because of rapid fire spread, today's we have so many more synthetic products, houses are burning quicker, there's higher heat. we find exposures are closer, so it takes more people and more coverage. But when we built the model, historically in fire service, it was to get to the seat of the fire, typically the front door of a home. The challenge we have today in cities like Toronto, with huge high-rise construction, with 35% of our residents living in high-rise condos or townhouses, really, we have to look at a high-rise as a vertical street. How long does it take us to get to the seat of the fire? It could be 30 floors up. We've got to look at a different model when we get into high-rises. Because originally, response times, if you could get to a building, then you just need a truck. Now we have to look at call volumes closer. We have to look at high-rises differently. We have to start looking at what it truly takes to manage high-rises in complex cities like this city that has one of the highest numbers of high-rise builds anywhere in the entire world.
You're saying you need to look at high-rises, so you haven't done it already. Do you really mean that?
There's no fire service looking at vertical. There's no one's doing it differently. We're looking at the best practice out there. High-rises are so challenging because there's so many differences, whether they're sprinkled. There's so many designs that one size doesn't fit all. So we've got the benefit we have in this country is very good building standards compared to our peers. When you look at Europe, they're going back to high-rises made out of total wood. That provides a whole other challenge.
Does the City of Toronto Fire Service currently meet whatever standards they use to build fire departments by? You mentioned that NFPA standard. The standards that are in use, does the Toronto Fire Service currently meet that with its staff shortfall that exists right now?
I think the answer is when you look at the NFPA 1710, this city does not meet that standard.
And so we're going further away from it.
No city in North America, no large city is meeting them. We're all struggling to meet a particular standard with mostly road distance and travel time.
So it seems to me that our population has increased in the last 10, 15 years with all the construction of high-rises that has happened, especially in this ward. Shouldn't we be increasing the number of trucks rather than decreasing it? We currently don't meet the standard.
Right now, we're driven to a budget target, and that's a reason for the decision. We need to look ahead, I absolutely agree, and to look at the growth and what we need for tomorrow's fire service, absolutely.
Okay, let's go to John, and then over here, and then down here, and then we'll come back to Kate.
We've been talking about fire, but I understand that a good percentage of the calls are health-related. And if you look at this area of Toronto, first of all, you've got a senior's residence right next door. You've got the Grenadier on Bloor, very close. The demographics say that this area is aging, unfortunately, quite rapidly. Do you take into account the health aspect? I know it's secondary in all probability to the fire service, but it's increasingly important. I mean, I understand the percentage of calls is increasing.
I think if we look at just a raw number, almost half our calls are medical related. We typically send one unit to a medical call depending on where it was. For example, if it was on a highway, we need additional trucks to deal with the safety and hazards, etc. But we need to look at every aspect. We look at all. So when we look at total call volume, we look at all the calls, the types of calls. They absolutely are all important.
Okay, that's...
As far as I understand right now, your budget is taking precedent over safety. Is that what you're telling us?
When we looked at last year with the inability to fill all the positions, and we do an analysis on call response, we look at the fire service last year, the data looks good. So it's hard for me to say, based on we were short 5.5 trucks every day last year, this year we're proposing to be short 5 trucks. It's really hard based on last year's data. There's nothing that I can show as definitive proof that there would be an impact to residents and or staff.
But what is safe? What is considered safe?
We'll make, our recommendation is to council. Again, I was asked this by a member of council at the budget committee. If you had 3.6%, would you be asking for the reductions? And I think the answer was, well, absolutely not. But council will make a decision based on the ability to meet the financial needs of the city. We're in no different position than the police chief is perplexed over his challenge, as is the EMS chief. It is challenging for all of us.
Well, somebody's got to ask this very simple question. Is this decision a service cut or an efficiency?
I use the term with staff. I don't think you can shrink yourself to greatness. So getting smaller isn't getting better. What we're trying to do is tighten your belts and do the best job we can. And again, safeguarding the needs of the citizens as well as our staff, that we put in some very difficult positions.
So there was no gravy. There was no gravy.
If there was gravy in the fire service, perhaps it's long gone. I haven't seen it. I'm new, and I've worked in other services. I started in Alberta, and what I've seen so far from Toronto, they're a very, very efficient service, a very effective service, a very busy service.
Okay, Louis, and then we
move
to this side.
I found all the facts that you have presented overwhelming and difficult to take it all in. I would like to ask, do all stations, well, we know our station does not have two trucks, it only has one. And when 5.5 trucks are taken out on a daily basis, how many does that, what's that proportion of all the trucks that are in the fire stations in Toronto? I think it would be useful to know what that represents.
There's 128 staffed units in the city of Toronto, or in other words, 128 trucks. There's different types. There's pumps, rescues, aerials, squads, special air lights. There's hazmat. We've got a variety. And what this service has done, like all major services, they've built models. What to send to medical calls, what to send to working fires, what to send to alarms, the difference between residential, commercial, industrial, institutional, high-rise, we have a different model. So every time a call comes, that's what the analysis is done at our dispatch center. They understand the type of call location and then determine the call response. So we send a variety of units from different distances as required. But we start with 128.
Yeah, Chief, can you, you probably can't, but could you guarantee the truck count will never go below 123? And I've got a second question when you get back.
If I had, sir, I wish I could, because most services do have a minimum. Toronto's one of the only services I'm aware of that does not have a minimum. Most have a minimum. And then they have a mechanism either to call in off-duty firefighters or other options to keep it to a minimum.
Okay. Next question is, I find this particularly galling, to be honest with you. This station, Runnymede, was hit 5 years ago when you took an aerial off them. Now you're spending over $1 million to refurbish a fire hall in the exhibition. I suspect the truck for that hall will come from Lansdowne. I suspect. So you've taken a truck out of Lansdowne, you've taken an aerial out of Runnymede, now you're closing the hall, you're taking a pumper off of up in Rexdale, eh? To the people in the audience, West Command is Command 4. I think this command is particularly getting hard hit. Will the truck come out of Lansdowne?
We haven't made that decision. One of the challenges we have is that originally there was a master plan the fire department did. And when they looked at the master plan, it talked about the need for 4 additional stations in the city. The master plan also went on to say that when each of those opened, there was the ability to move existing crews to cover some of those stations. So the goal was to keep the 128 trucks, but to move trucks to cover the additional stations. When I put this budget forward, I was very clear that we do not have the ability to fill new stations because we're depleting our resources at this time. So any new stations will then have to be requisitioning for staff as well as the capital of the building. So it will be capital as well as operating.
Could I give you a brief history lesson? The way the fire service worked in the 60s and the 70s, they would close halls and combine them. Take, for instance, Lansdowne. There was a hall at Queen and Cowan, another hall at Perth. So the city fathers thought, we'll combine them. So the two pumpers would go into the Lansdowne Hall. Each pumper would maintain their own running district, and this was a cheaper way to do it. So when outside chiefs come in now, they look around the city and they see, oh, there's a double pumper hall. That's like a gold mine to us. We can use that. They don't realize that those pumpers are over 3,000 and 4,000 runs each. And now they're going to take one out, and jack their runs up to well over 5,000. There comes a point in time where over 5,000 runs is just too much if you want to get your training done, the health of firefighters, servicing the community, and that's a problem. And I don't think chiefs from the past, even the North York guys, fully appreciated the double pumper halls in the city of Toronto and how they got to that point. So if you take it off of Lansdowne, you really hammer the other truck. And to start a fire hall up in the exhibition, I can't believe you'd spend that amount of money to put a hall in the CNE. You talk about response times, add a minute just getting out of the CNE to the call. Anyway, sorry to hammer you.
You're right, and I accept that. I think the decision on the CNE was made because of the changes coming with the Pan American Games. And when the Athlete Village becomes residential, we start to look at some of the growth there. We've got pockets within the city that we're having a real challenge. I think in the future, when we look at high-rises, we have to look at a different model of call response. I call it the storefront approach. We need to make agreements with developers in high-rise and in some of the new large areas where we actually physically put stations within those developments, because the ability to get up and down these busy streets is just getting more and more difficult. So in the future, we have to look at it a lot.
$1.89 million, and in your calculations, you're going to sell the property, correct? So what did you budget to receive from selling the station itself?
At this point in time, this is a proposal to the budget, so it really goes forward ultimately for council decision. And until they either agreed or disagreed, there's been no decision what to do with the station.
But if you close it, you're going to sell it.
The fire station property is owned by the city. So what would happen would be that...
It doesn't go in their budget.
No, it doesn't. So it would go out to the city or the departments and then say, would you like to use this property? And they'll say yes or no. If they say no, it goes to Build Toronto and it gets sold. So the profit from the station does not go back into the fire chief's budget. I just want to make that completely clear. Yeah.
But they never sold fire halls in the past.
At the back there, and then we'll come down to Peggy.
Hi, just the very beginning of your remarks, you told us why this hall was chosen. And it seemed to me quite ironic that this is one of the most efficient, best-run fire halls. It's 45 seconds quicker response than any other fire hall in the city. And that's, ironically, the reason to close it. Just comments on that.
No, when I look at the run area, I look at the run district, you're right, it is very effective. And unfortunately, again, call volume, the ability to cover from other stations is the decision. When we made these decisions, I worked with the deputies, worked with all the shift commanders, people that have, you know, around the table, lots of experience in the city, and they were all tough decisions. All five, we spent, I think, in the last meeting, about 6.5 hours just reviewing all the final data. It was a tough, tough choice in each and every one.
Thank you, Chief. I'll just add a little bit to that. It's quick response time because that particular pocket, and we looked at the city as a whole. So the map is a pretty good visual because you can see black dots are our stations. So when you see roughly how far apart they are, with the concentration of fire halls in this particular area, if we have to go to closing a fire station, we have to try to make the best choice citywide. No one's going to like it. It's going to be impactful anywhere. With response times being that good, that just basically proves that we have a high concentration. So the ability to cover the same area with or without that station is better here than somewhere else. So that's, I don't know if that helps you a little bit or not.
Peggy, and then we'll go to the back and then over here.
Yeah, just a point and a question. I guess, you know, the point that other people have been making that, you know, these are capital investments in infrastructure, and you need to look at not just what is there today, but what will be there. And with the plan for intensification for this city, we're finding in our area, and Sarah knows better than anyone because you go to all the development meetings, we are facing an unprecedented number of high-rise developments of various sizes in this area. And the lack of service, I think, in that area in the future, if this cut is made, will... It's punting a problem to the future that someone else is going to have to deal with, and investing again in that infrastructure becomes very problematic. So I just want to emphasize that point. My other question is that this is another magnificent example of a lovely old fire station. It's an older building, and I just wonder, how old is the building? When was it built? And does anyone know, has the city contemplated, if this isn't a fire station, would it just be torn down, or what would be the outcome? It would be a tragedy to lose this wonderful old station. Obviously, the priority is the service, but the building itself is a wonderful old building.
I'm not sure of the exact age of the station, I'll be honest with you. The date is, believe it or not, on it, but I don't recall it right now, but it is one of the older ones in the city. As far as the city's plans for it, as we've already covered, if this were to happen, that would be the city's decision.
I think John can actually give us a date on this building, I believe.
Yeah. You may not know this, but when Swansea was a village, by the way, Swansea was the last part of Toronto to have volunteers. Matter of fact, the paneling originally in this council chamber, and this is what it was done by the volunteer firemen. So there's a very close relationship. The building that is now the fire hall was the fire hall for the village of Swansea. Downstairs you had the lockup. I'm not sure whether they've been taken out yet or not, but maybe we should consider putting them back in use if this goes through.
And I'm afraid, who did I put in there?
You said that I didn't. Upstairs were the council, was the village offices before this building was built. So it's an integral part of Swansea. It's very difficult to talk about closing the building without thinking in terms of what this is and what it can be.
And when we did those analyses for the Runnymede station and maybe for the other station, the other four that you're talking about, did you take out that station or take away the service in over the past year or 2 years and rerun the analysis to see what would it have meant to the response rates and so on? Like what's the impact 5 years ago or 4 years or 3 years ago if those stations weren't there?
We went back from 2006 to 2011 because 2012 we haven't got their full year data. So we went from 2006 to 2011. So we analyzed all calls from 2006 to 2011. And then we reran the data. If we didn't have the station in place, what would have happened? And some of that, again, is theoretical because the original data from 2006 to 11 is actual. We pull it out of our CAD system, our AutoCAD, and it's actual run times. But when we project if the station wasn't there, it's a theoretical calculation.
Yeah, like what I'm talking about is, you know, one truck's off doing something else, and you got to call for another one, right? So that's the kind of analysis that would be interesting to know. You know, when you've got two or three trucks at a time, you know, and then you don't have that station anymore. What happens in the next couple of months, and how far do you have to go, right?
It's a very complex running data because you not only got to, you can't make the assumption that every truck is in the station and available all the time. We start to look at 189,000 calls. That means 189,000 times trucks are out doing something. So we try to run data if the first truck wasn't there, and even if the second truck wasn't there, how long would it take to get a third truck? But in large calls, that isn't even complex enough. So it is one of the positions I want to look at in the future, is trying to get an analyst, someone who can specialize in understanding and running data. We need to do what's called modeling. We need to do a better job at that.
I just want to say one thing. I stopped by the Runnymede station yesterday afternoon. I wanted to go talk to the firefighters. They weren't there. They were out doing what they do best. So good example how that truck was being used. And if we needed them to help with the fire, they weren't there. Let me come to this gentleman here, and then we'll come back here.
Chief Sales, in 2008, the department participated in a study with 14 other fire departments across North America called the WPI-FPRF study. It was by two researchers in the United States. The conclusions of that study were that Toronto fire turnouts were the slowest of the 14 fire departments that were measured at the time in 2008. In 2009, 2010, and 2011, Toronto fire promised to reduce turnout time performance by 60 seconds. In 2012, Toronto Fire canceled that commitment. This is before you took over as fire chief. Can you explain why Toronto Fire canceled that 60-second turnout time reduction commitment? And what has happened in the interim to Toronto Fire turnout time performance?
Well, again, as you said, that was before my time, so I can't look back and understand why decisions were made. All I can tell you what's going forward. Going forward, we had a meeting recently with all the GTA communities. And one of the reasons we had, because we started to look at response times, we looked at turnout times, we looked at dispatch times, and there seemed to be some, I'll use the term, anomalies. So we sat down with all our peers from the GTA, and we reviewed our data and found out that out of the 9 departments represented, 6 of us were doing it differently. There was 6 differences. So we made a motion to go to what's called Zone 4 of the Ontario Fire Chiefs. It became a motion on the floor for Ontario Fire Chiefs. We're now going to build a standard for the entire province where everybody looks at dispatch identically, and we look at turnout identically, and we look at road response identically. You'd think that it would be done the same, and unfortunately we found out it wasn't. So we find there's differences from 0 to 30 seconds. So the first step is we need to understand our data. But what Mike has done, I'll let Mike explain what he's done here within the city of Toronto. What it looked like, we've got challenges with our response times.
What we did, and to my knowledge, might be one of the few that have done it so far, is we went to every station and took 2 measurements in turnout time. One from where they would typically be during the daytime hours, would be a common area where they'd be training or something like that. And then again at night when it's downtime. So that would typically be from the upstairs of a second story, two-story fire hall. And what we found is, now we're also challenged today with safety measures that are put in place to keep us safe, keep the firefighters safe, are slowing us down. For instance, when I started 32 years ago, I was standing on the back step with my arm in the leather strap, putting my coat on, and that was acceptable. Well, we've got smarter, realizing that's not a safe practice. So now every firefighter has to get completely dressed, and now we wear bunker suits, which is basically putting on a pair of pants and a jacket, completely done up, sitting down in the truck, seatbelt on before the truck moves. So those are challenges for us. That's adding time. So we measured everything done safely, and what we found is NFPA gives us a guideline time to try to achieve. We're having trouble achieving it. I spoke to the other departments, they're having trouble as well. So what we're doing now is, now we've got a baseline of how long it takes us on the average scale of the fire hall and what slows us down. Practices, we have fire poles in 2-story stations, and for some reason it doesn't seem to get used as much as others. So we're looking at all these things. Now you're talking shaving 5 seconds here, 10 seconds there, but to us in our world, that's huge.
May I have a follow-up question? The FPRF study tested Toronto Fire along with 13 other North American fire departments, and every single fire department did exactly the same test. every single fire department donned their bunker gear, completed the same task, and Toronto Fire was 60 seconds slower than the average of the other 13 North American fire departments. We're not talking about shaving 5 seconds. The important thing that was identified by that report was they compared Toronto Fire's deficiencies to NFPA, and 60% of Toronto Fire's deficiency to NFPA standards is due to turnout time. Only 10% of the deficiency to meeting NFPA standards are travel time. And the position of this station only affects travel time. It's turnout time that's the major issue, and Toronto Fire recognized it was a major issue in 2008 and promised to fix it, and quite frankly has done nothing in the interim to fix that problem. You hired 40 firefighters last year. That did not improve turnout time. You are going to build 4 new fire stations from the last year's budget, and that is not going to fix turnout time either. It will improve turnout time, but turnout time is only 10% of your problem. So why aren't you addressing the turnout time issue and fixing it, benchmarking these other 13 fire departments that were able to do it faster than you? Mississauga turns out 60 seconds faster than Toronto Fire does. They're right next door.
Mississauga admitted that they calculate their time different, and their time difference is 25 seconds difference because of that calculation. They're the biggest anomaly, and they found out that's one of the challenges. Cities like Mississauga, they tack it on to driving time versus we tack it on to turnout time. So that's a whole other situation that we can review. Toronto also has unique stations. For example, Adelaide Station, where you have a 6-truck station. They're not single-run stations, and so you've got to compare apples to apples. That's a whole other issue. It's not about Runnymede. You and I can have a conversation about that, and I can give you a lot more data than that one study. I can give you a lot of data on options and challenges we have, but that's a whole different situation than why we're here today. So, you know, going to focus on Runnymede.
It's the Runnymede Fire Hall, right?
Yeah.
Because they keep referring to station on Runnymede as the Swansea one.
You have to understand that not all media know where Swansea stops. And even though I was trying to correct them, I kept calling it the Runnymede Station.
Let's say even Hyde Park then, or Bloor West Village Station.
Bloor West Village, but I wanted it to be on Runnymede, but as you say, yes, it was a bit misleading. You are correct with that one. But it is the Runnymede Station on Runnymede and McGregor up near the up near the Runnymede school. It's up near
the alarms. School. It's really taking us away from being prepared to answer real calls. So we're trying to, I guess we'll say there's some punitive impact, and it has reduced the false alarms. Our challenge is when the alarm comes in, as Mike said, hopefully a school is going to be a false alarm, but you don't know. So we've got to respond as if it is a working fire until we know otherwise. And that's a challenge because it is too dangerous to say, well, let's just send one truck and check it out. I mean, England is having some huge financial challenges. The federal government reduced 60% of the funding for fire. It's funded there mostly federally. They've reduced fire stations by 20%. Stations in England, some cities that I've looked at, are now, when an alarm goes off, they're telling people, if you haven't seen smoke or fire, it's too early to call us. Now, they also have the highest fatality rate in the United Kingdom with that model. Well, right now, throughout 2011, the average response, the 90% on 90% of the time, they responded in 196 seconds. That was the number.
No, I definitely agree with Carol. We've got thousands of students in a very small area, and those streets are not easy to get through. First time I tried, I got lost. And I know firefighters know the routes, but those are small, windy, narrow roads, so that would also slow the time of any truck coming in. I think that's something which people are going to be doing emails. It's a very good point to add our seniors. I just want to actually mention one thing. So fire trucks, they're brilliant. The firefighters are fantastic, and they fight fires. But they're also usually the first one on the scene of a medical emergency, and we just heard that we could be losing some of our qualified EMS in our ward. So our fire trucks are going to be even more important for first response on a medical emergency. We have a lot of seniors in our ward.
We have a lot of fire trucks going for medical besides fire. I don't know if we actually keep statistics on whether they went for medical or fire. I'm not sure on that. But when I did a ride-along over at the Kiel station, ours was all medical. they told me I couldn't put out a fire, but we didn't actually have a fire call. They were all medical. And I think that also is part of what we need our firefighters and our fire trucks for, to help when EMS can't get there quite as quickly because they're suffering cutbacks as well. It's sort of a comment more than a question. But
no, I totally agree. I think that fire service are there to provide safety protection for the property and people within a geographic service area. Because we're there and we need to be there, if we can add value by going to medical calls and assisting with fire prevention in areas like the from our residential programs, we need to be doing more and being very active and being very supportive of the community and still being available to respond to calls within that geographic area. But again, sometimes we call ourselves the fire service people, you know, that labels us as just fire, but there's so many type of emergencies the fire responds to these days in particular. It's just amazing.
Gentlemen in the back row, and then gentlemen in the back, and then we'll come.
During your decision-making process, was there ever a report generated internally, a report or memorandum, and if so, can we look at it?
No.
I understand the decision-making. This is a big decision that you're making, and I would expect some sort of report, some sort of conclusions from the analysis, something, like some sort of final report that you looked at or the committee as a whole looked at. But no report was generated.
Not a council type report. We did to do analysis. We do statistical analysis. We run data. We do modeling. We do part of that, but it's not in the format of a written report, no.
Or recommendation, like a recommendation that you made this decision upon?
Well, I think that from one budget year to the next, this has been about a six-month journey to get where we are today. It wasn't something that we sat down in an afternoon and determined. This was a six-month journey, starting with the budget directions, then looking at what we did in 2011, what we did in 12, what we need to do in 13, and making some decisions on what would have to change. So we looked at every single aspect, and that's all part of the 2013 budget exercise. Is part of the work we do annually in regards to our budgeting. Every department feeds up information, what they need to continue operating, additional monies, changes. So that's all an ongoing process.
Gentlemen in the back, and then we're going to come to the lady here.
Dave, I do work beside your men and women on the front lines every day. I'm a paramedic. I work with them, they do a great job. Great to have him there. It's good to have him there, and I'm making some cuts. But if I might digress, just on top, just a bit concerning the ambulance stations and the ambulance services. In the new redeployment in the brand new year, the advanced care station down at Board Clemington, the advanced field paramedics there will not be there. That means they're coming from further away. City of Toronto instituted advanced care paramedics over 25 years ago to bring the skills, the drugs of the front line of the emergency to people's houses, and this would be cut. It's a serious concern, as you were talking before about the health and safety of people. This will definitely impact you and will lead to destructive, devastating causes. Talking about loss of life, in 1999, there was an 18-year-old gentleman named Joshua Fuelli that died because of an asthma attack. And from that coroner's jury, the recommendation was that there would be more advanced life support paramedics available in the city. This new budget, there will be a cut in that. There will be less advanced care life paramedics there to save your life. So, yes, going back to the fire department, your guys and girls, and cutting the service will lead to less, and we'll be needing more of them on more medical calls because there won't be any more ambulances available in the city. It is dire straits there for ambulances, And we need more fire. We need more fire personnel on there to help save people's lives. So, thank you.
If you would not cut, the gentleman asked more or less what I wanted to ask. If you would not cut now Runnymede and you couldn't reduce the budget, would it go to City Council and would the City Council then decide if it will be closed or not?
Absolutely. We're asked to put a budget together for the Budget Committee. The Budget Committee hears and they have discussions. All they do is ask questions to clarify. It will be Council's decision to accept or reject any item of any budget.
So which means that the council, maybe some from Scarborough or something, could decide if we have to close Runnymede?
So what happens now is, as you know, on Monday and Tuesday, residents can come and do deputations to the Budget Committee on the 2013 budget. It then goes to budget wrap-up, and eventually in January, it comes to City Council, where we just talk budget. That is why I'm encouraging you, if you can't come and do a deputation, do an email or a letter to the mayor and all 44 councillors, because I'm only one vote.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Believe me, I'll be standing up and speaking quite loudly about this, because what we need two options. I have asked finance in the city to find us alternative funding for a station. If not, the only option I have is to go to the budget chief and say, please add this to the property tax increase. He will be able to tell me how much that would mean on every resident across the city on a property tax increase for percentage.
That would be very little. That would be a couple of dollars for every property.
If that. So those are my two options. I'm working on them, trying to find alternative funding first. But normally when you find alternative funding, they're cutting something else. So my motion will probably be to increase the property tax increase, which I think right now is 1.95 is what they've come up with right now to balance the budget. How much more would that add to it? It would be a small point something.
I'm sure every resident would gladly pay an extra $2-3 and keep the station.
So that is where I have to go around and persuade the rest of council to agree with me. And I, believe me, your input helps me a lot. Because there's other councillors who actually are losing, not losing bodies, but having different levels of staffing, losing a pumper truck. We're not the only ward being affected by this budget, but we are the only one losing an actual station. Okay, let's come down the front here, and then we'll come back over there. Yes.
Chief, could you help enlighten everyone here as the number of calls? I think you mentioned 180,000, 190,000 calls last year. How many calls would the city of Toronto run at the day of amalgamation, for example, the year of amalgamation? That was the first part of the question.
And I don't have that number.
I thought it was around 112, 120,000, something like that.
I'm sorry, before my time, I can't help with that.
So basically, I think the calls are up probably about 70%, if I go by my memory.
I think people quote stats and data. And I think if we looked at the actual fire calls in the city of Toronto, actual fire calls, events, is going down. But because of the hazards we face in the buildings that are burning, because of now exposures or houses are getting larger exposures, that means the distance to the next property owner. There's less distance between standalone homes. Now, in many cases with the apartments, multiple alarm fires, 39% are in high-rise residential. It's a different world. So we're sending more trucks, even though there may be less calls, we're sending more trucks to those fire calls. And the fire loss is still continuing to climb because fire spread so quickly and because property is valued so highly. So dollar losses, unfortunately, still are climbing, and we're still sending more and more trucks.
And then another thing is that from what I understand, we are, the city of Toronto has grown in population, or swelled probably by about 550,000. And the relationship or the numerical variation between firefighters to the number of people that we serve, has it gone up? Maybe the public here.
I don't think that the city had 128 trucks when amalgamation occurred in 1998, and that number stayed consistent to 2012. So there's really been no growth in the fire service in 14 years.
My name is Frank Ragnano with the Toronto Firefighters Association. I'd like to thank the councillor for having this meeting. I think it's very important, especially for people. Fire chief, obviously he's used to hot situations, but he's handled himself really well. We just came up about the tax implications. We looked at it, it's a savings of $12 million. When you look at your residential tax bill, you'll see what you're being charged for the fire service. Overall, it's $238. When you take a look at the $12 million, it equates to less than 70 cents a month. That's what the city's going to be saving here. And I can understand the fire chief, he's just come in August. He's been given this, and he's got his orders from budget committee, and he's doing his job. But I think, at the very least, if you look at this ward, and we've looked at the demographics, we looked at the 2001 census, the 2006, it's getting, as other people have alluded to, it's getting older. You've heard the fire chief, that puts even more emphasis on us getting there with the resources that we need. And I think at the very least, if council does anything, this is the master fire plan. This was done in 2007. I happened to work on one prior to that in 97. I can tell you, over a year to produce, everything's done. And I can understand the budget and the long hours and everything else he has to come with. This is the briefing, though, that's going to cut the trucks. There's a real big difference here. We need to have counselors on the committee. We need to have your firefighters. We need to have the community before we engage in cutting a service, such as the fire service or the EMS service. We need to figure out what the consequences are. Because to be wrong costs someone their life. And we got to make sure we get it right. So I would hope in January, if council does anything, delay it so we can study it, till we can figure it out, and at the end of the day say, yeah, maybe that's the best choice, or no, it's not. But let's not just make it on money. And that's what I'm afraid the decision is being based on, is just dollars and cents. And I think we should all be very concerned about that. Thank you.
I'm going to let Bill go again, and then we'll come to other people.
The lawyer in me says, stop using the word best choice. That implies an empirical situation that this is a very desirable choice that you're making. What I'm hearing from you is this is a recommendation that is made with reluctance and a great deal of regret. It's basically that old joke, do you want to be burned alive, boiled in oil, boiled in water, or shot? Make your best choice. You're still dead. So what I'm saying is stop using the word best choice, because you're implying when it goes to some counselor that thinks 70 cents a person is an important savings, that you're implying from an empirical standard that it's the best choice in the world. What you mean is, it's the worst, but given other worse choices, this is the one we're regrettably making. And that's what should be very clear. I'm just saying, there's no joke about, and I want to take my, that Justice Speaker talked about this trial. There's a guy known as Silky Haynes, he was an insurance lawyer. And this kid drowned, fell off into the deep end of the pool, but Silky Haynes kept describing the edge of the pool as a safety ledge. And he knew things were going great when the plaintiff's lawyer started calling it a safety ledge. But when the judge was summing things up before he went to make his decision, he called it a safety ledge. At the end of the day, the hotel was not found responsible because the judge found it was a safety ledge, not a ledge where somebody fell off. Stop calling it a best choice. It's the worst choice. But of all the worst choices, it's the least worst. So please describe it that way. Thanks.
Thank you, Bill.
Let me just go to the lady in the blue coat, and then we'll come back to Veronica. Yes, ma'am.
So is this what I understand, that you based your budget model on the data from 2006 to 2011 for this area, yet the CNE was a decision made on a projected development. So is your data in your budget? As you can see, if an area grows, there's more money. There's more people, there's more money. So is your budget really based on data of 2006 to 2011?
I think when it comes to the choice of the stations, we look at 5 years of data for that. when we look at our budget in general, we look at a lot of factors. But when you do an analysis on station, and we came to that difficult choice of looking at reductions, we look back 5 years. Because if you look at data further in calls, the further you go out, it's not that relevant. So the last 5 years were gave us a good picture.
I know that our community has already been, it's in the process of being compromised with some high rises in the community down in Swansea. And my understanding is that from that this station has a ladder or whatever that is only appropriate to high rises. Is that correct?
No, I think this station has a pump without an aerial.
Okay. So, in other words, you're recognizing in this station that there is a need to address some high-rise issues. High-rise building issues. Because I noticed that your conversation was mostly about residential, like individual homeowner, single-family dwelling. So, I also understand that you're already facing a bit of a failure in the time test for arrival at some of the, especially in the condo areas. In our area, which is like hugely, as I said, being compromised, but the reality is that's where it is. So what, is there a liability factor here that you are in the face of this, in this changing dynamic in the neighborhood? You are also, without even thinking about that issue, you're entering into a liability issue, because the community can say, well, hello, you in the face of, you recognize that the dynamic is changing, so you better, and yet you have taken away the one thing that would possibly save a lot of people.
Two things. In fire stations, with 82 stations, normally you want the first truck out the door to be what's called a pumper. It's a quicker, smaller unit. And then you spread throughout the city based on need, aerial trucks to attend to high rise, or you can use them for other uses. They're what's called an elevated waterway. You use them for rescue. There's a number of reasons. We have less aerials. We have less squads. So you put a combination of units to cover and deal with your hazards. Ultimately, every single department puts forward proposals to their councils. There is a standard. National Fire Protection Association creates standards in regards to equipment, standards for call response, a number of training, etc. And departments try to meet those standards. But ultimately, the decisions with a municipal council, they make the choice on what standard of care, what standards of service they're going to provide for the residents. And so in these days of fiscal restraints, many communities are reducing the size of emergency services as well as other city services. Our American counterparts, unfortunately, based on their challenges, many cities, they're reducing 20%. Not because they want to, but because they have to. It's a sad time.
Anyone who hasn't spoken want to ask a question? I know you've got some other people want to go second.
Well, you've said the response time of Runnymede is 45 seconds better than other stations. What are the response times of Kiel, Swansea, and Jane stations? And how can this will this affect removing Runnymede? How much time in seconds will it add to the response time of each of these averages?
Two of those stations are below the four-minute threshold. One is slightly above the four-minute threshold. And we see that if they respond to this area, it could be in the neighborhood of 26 seconds. That's what we estimate. Again, there's so many variables. Depends when the calls occur. Because, again, average times are very good. But if calls are happening in rush hours or times of high traffic, it is an absolute challenge to get to. We're just challenged. And that's why we have a 90% standard. And make sure we do 90% of the time.
Is 30 seconds or 26 seconds not considered a lot of time added to a response call?
Well, the challenge that we have in the fire world, having a background in fire, and I did EMS as well, and if someone falls and breaks an arm, as unfortunate as that is, if you get there in 4 minutes or 14, it's still a broken arm, and you can deal with it. The challenge of fire, fires spread quickly, fires change. When we get the call, our goal is to be there in 6 minutes, because in 6 minutes, it looks totally different. It's a difference between keeping it contained to a room or keeping it contained to a floor. So the goal is quick arrival is absolutely critical. It would depend on the type of call if there was an impact. And it depends if we were first in, because there's two standards. I've been focusing a lot on the 4 minute driving distance. There is a second standard called 8 minute. That's when all trucks to be on scene within 8 minutes driving distance. And in some cases that's 5 trucks, in some cases it's 7 or 8 trucks, depending on the type of call. So the goal is both. We want to get the first truck on scene. We also want to get all trucks on scene. And we are being challenged now on both of those numbers.
Again, Chief, this is before your time, but when amalgamation was forced upon the City of Toronto by the provincial government, the city commissioned a study with KPMG. It was completed in 1999. The framework of the study was what's the most efficient and effective way to save the fire department and the city money, because we're going to now be amalgamated. We can eliminate stations, eliminate fire trucks, etc. What they, to their surprise, found out was that the standards were actually below what they should be. And instead of being able to cut personnel, they actually, the recommendations from KPMG were to increase the number of staff that were required. Can you tell me which of the recommendations in the KPMG study that the city spent hundreds of thousands of dollars commissioning, how many of those recommendations have been met 13, 14 years later?
The KPMG study originally talked about the need to build additional fire stations within a 4 to 6 year window, as I recall. Some of those are still on the books and they're being built now.
Four to six years, and now we're looking at about 13 years later, and they're still not acted upon. The recommendations in that study are still not acted upon?
No, not from the KPMG study.
No. And then since there was a subsequent master plan, another study, an update on the master plan, there's been 5 studies since those days. Well, we're going back to 87.
Right. And has the city paid for the recommendations in those studies to be completed?
Typically in master plans are forward-thinking documents. What the master plans do is lay out the roadmap. But master plans don't lay out the financial. What happens on an annual basis or in a 10-year capital plan, we put forward, and we've got a 10-year capital plan now. Unfortunately, what happens typically in challenging budget years, that 10-year gets pushed out, and some of those projects become longer time. And that's really what's been happening. Those have been on the books, and they keep getting pushed out.
So what I'm getting at is, I don't mean to monopolize the time, but what I'm getting at is this study made recommendations to increase, not decrease, the service levels. And in the past 13 years, the population of Toronto has increased drastically. So we were below the standards 13 years ago. We've not completed the recommendations of that study, and population has drastically increased. So we're getting ourselves further in a hole. We should be moving in the other direction towards getting closer to fulfilling those positions. And I think if the case is put strongly enough and graphically enough by the fire department or by fire service, the councillors will probably listen. I don't think a strong enough case has been made to council to get them to act on the recommendations of the study that they in fact commissioned.
I've done many master plans, and one of the real problems is when you do master plans, these are plans to look at providing service. They're service-based models. And unfortunately, then the challenge we have as administrators is selling that as a financial plan and selling it to council, because when you do master plans, we look at providing service, we look at service improvements, we look at promotion, and it's then we've got it. We're challenged to find ways to finance or afford it, and that's one of the problems with master plans. They're typically accepted, but that doesn't automatically give you approval of spending dollars, and that's where it really falls down. We need to have a model that when you build a master plan, there's some financial agreement, but that doesn't happen. And the problem is we have a document that really we're challenged to find the financial wherewithal to afford.
Thank you.
I think it's too bad that our provincial representative is gone. The question about emergency services came up and how some cuts are going to be taking place. I've worked in a hospital for 30 years or so, in a community hospital, and in the last year or two I've had occasion to spend a fair amount of time in the emergency department, in particular at St. Joe's, visiting friends and helping them out. And I would like to inform, I think is what I wanted to do, is inform people here, if they don't know it, that when an ambulance and the, and somebody can correct me if I'm wrong, an ambulance arrives at the emergency department in our hospitals and they walk in with the patient, those emergency staff are not allowed to leave the patient until that patient receives a bed. Now, I don't know if anybody can read between the lines what that means, okay? If that isn't efficiency or inefficiency, I don't know what it is. And in my times, and it's not a criticism to you folks or to anybody, just that's the way it is. Being there, there were times when three pairs of people would be coming in and staying at the stretcher with the patient because the emergency departments are so backed up. And I can understand then why the firefighters are doing more of that kind of calls than putting out fire. So I suspect that the definition or your work, however you define your work, has changed over the decades and is going more to doing this kind of work of health related than it is to firefighting. So I just want to bring that to your attention. The system isn't working in many, many ways. And I understand what you're dealing with, budget cuts, and you, Sarah, as well. And so a few more cents isn't going to mean very much, but a few more cents here, a few more cents there. I've been a resident here, and you know the taxes aren't bad, but somewhere along the line, something's got to give. I wanted to also make a comment because the question of traffic time was talked about. I would like to ask what cooperation, what communication exists on an ongoing basis between the firefighters, fire service, and the police service and traffic service? Is there ongoing discussions? If a fire truck would need to come from Runnymede at this point to respond down to Lakeshore after our truck has gone and done there, and if, well, I'm going to tell you guys how you drive your trucks or where you go, but if you're going to come down Jane and try to get through the loop, oh sorry, it's up here with the construction that's going on now, I would suggest to you find another alternative. I can hear people laughing. It's not a laughing matter.
No, it
isn't. It's not a laughing matter, folks, okay? And we talk about losing a life or fire times, etc. Seconds here, seconds there. These are serious situations which our traffic people are not paying attention to when we have told them.
One of the greatest challenges is with growth, and with growth comes the traffic and problems. And we've got very sophisticated equipment in the communication center, and they have data. But sometimes things change quickly on the streets. So the advantage of having localized fire stations is that groups in the fire station have a responsibility. They go out and do a lot of work, make sure they know what's happening in their area, because they have a geographic area assigned. And that's really critical to have that local team that knows their area, knows where the road restrictions and limitations are. We also get updates on traffic into our systems, whether it's fire or EMS. They send us updates if there's a closure, for example, a water break or something like that. So we try to get that out to the crews and share that information. So, but even with that, the challenge, when it's rush hour and the roads are full of traffic, they can't pull to the right to let the fire units go by. And we've got, at times, we've got one of our largest stations on Adelaide, and there are times when it's just difficult even to get out of the station.
Can I just answer something Louis was mentioning? My understanding is that the province actually recently funded some nurses to be in emergency ward or in emergencies in the hospital so that the EMS could hand the patient off to the nurse. So that would allow them to get back on the road quicker. I just understood, just in the last 48 hours, that some of the hospitals have now pulled funding for one nurse. So I'm going to be looking into that one, because we want to get all our emergency services back on the roads doing what they do best as quickly as possible. But I will just say for EMS, I also spent a lot of time down at Emerge this last summer, and everyone was brilliant. I never once got the ambulance from up the street here. I always got them from out of town. Brilliant people. I got to learn about other parts of the city. But yes, this province did fund nurses just to take over the patients who came in through EMS, but that's now being basically lost, which is a great shame. Here, and then we'll come to you, sir.
Councillor Doucette, this is a question for you. To use Chief Sale's words, moving forward, we're having more what he says are vertical streets. And I'm thinking back to recent weeks in Dubai. They had a fire in one of these vertical streets. Thankfully, there was no loss of life, but it was very difficult for them to handle the fire and the evacuation and everything. So you've also said that you said something of talking with developers to perhaps put a station on site in these new developments. So the question to the councillor is, can Section 37 money be extracted, negotiated with the developer? Because as far as I'm concerned, this is a public good or a public benefit. And I'm thinking of something not as serious, but the Ridgeon Park Aquatic Center, which did get Section 37 money from Mr. Donald Trump and his Trump Tower, which is not exactly next door. With all this development that's happening, is there a possibility from a budget perspective to, if not keep this station, to return, you know, the service, the station, and so forth in this area?
So Section 37, for people who don't know, is a formula which is the city staff come up with a formula for the mass and density beyond what the property should have. Section 37 dollar figure is negotiated between the city and the developer. Once the dollar figure is negotiated, the planner, myself, the community, and the developer get together and work out where that money is going to be spent in the local community. It can only be spent on capital projects. So no, I can't use any Section 37 money, which we actually don't have any right now, nothing has come to us recently, to keep this station open. Yes, it could be spent to build a station, but then the fire department, fire service, would have to take over the running, possibly $2 million a year, running of that station. That's the crux. We can't use Section 37 for operations, only for capital. And the other problem is, when a developer starts building, you don't actually see Section 37 money until the building comes above grade. So even though we've had two enormous holes in the ground at Tridel, we have not seen any money yet. So we need fire services now. None of the developments going up in our area, we're going to see money for the next three years. Great idea, but you can only spend it on capital. So unless they can take over operations, it's not going to work. But you're not the first one to ask me that, believe me. Yes, sir?
Just to follow up on a point that the gentleman back here made about how often and how long ambulances stay at hospitals. Mm-hmm. When after a patient's been released to a hospital, that ambulance also has to be cleaned, and there's a long prep time that occurs after a call. And as you mentioned, nurses being pulled from that service as well. It's been my experience to see that the fire department in many cases is still the fault, that it falls back onto the fire service for especially critical care calls, whether it's Delta or Echo, where in my opinion, having sat on our coroner's inquiry this year as well, 30 seconds absolutely makes a huge difference of time and response. And, you know, I'd be very curious to know what the statistics are in terms of your support of other services within the city, whether it's fire or police services or EMS. And I think that that's a, you know, a heavy workload on the force as well. And certainly something needs to be considered that, you know, every time some other budgetary group has a deficiency or a shortfall, that often, you know, they're cutting something that has a knock-on effect. And it seems to me that fire services in particular in this city are taking a big beating when it comes to that budget. You haven't stood your ground. Sorry, that's an inappropriate comment. But Chief Blair obviously is quite comfortable drawing a line in the sand and saying, I'm not changing my budget, I can't make those cuts. And I'm not suggesting that that we willfully say no to the city's request for a budget reduction, but you are taking an awfully big beat year over year, or, you know, taking a hit, and I think it should stop. You do perform an admirable service, and you support a lot of other services in the city, and I think you're really one of the most valuable organizations we have, and I'd really hate to see you leave my community.
First time. Yes, sir.
I just thought I'd share a couple of stories. I'm a resident of Gregor Avenue, and we moved in 1996, and within a couple of years, we had a small fire in the laundry room. And I can certainly attest to the response time being excellent when the crew arrived on the run from the station down the street and had our dryer out on the driveway and under control. In moments, it's experiences like that that make you appreciate what you people do. And within several years after that, I'm sorry to say that my father perished in a house fire in Don Mills in 1999. And it struck me, had he been a lucky resident on our street, on McGregor Avenue, he might still be alive today, based on the fantastic response time that we have enjoyed and counted on as residents in the neighborhood. So I find this discussion of dollars and cents to be somewhat secondary to the life and death issue that it really can be. And I see this as such an essential service and something that it's really something to be emotional about. And I just returned from being away, and I find this a very emotional issue, and hope that somehow this can be resolved in a way that's, you know, life and death at the top of the list, and, you know, maybe we can make the dollars work somehow. Second hand.
Anyone else? This could be lady behind you.
Yeah, okay. I just about this too. I called 911 quite a few times after because of my husband and so on. And the first one always responding is the fire trucks. They're here in no time at all. But it takes a long time, quite a long time, for an ambulance to show up. So if we would have to wait long enough for the ambulance instead of the fire trucks, it would really make a huge difference. I always was surprised how fast the fire truck were here, and they knew what to do and how to help. And, you know, and then, okay, you wait another 5 minutes or even 10 minutes until you finally get an ambulance. That can make a huge, huge difference. If your husband or whoever in your family has a heart attack or a stroke or lies on the floor, I tell you, 5 minutes to you is half an hour.
I agree.
So the fire truck there.
Chief Sales, this is a previous gentleman actually highlighted an important point in that the response times, I think you mentioned earlier, are about 192 seconds for this station, for the driving time. For the rest of the city as a whole, I believe the figure is 267 seconds on the 90th percentile, or about 4 minutes and 27 seconds. This particular pocket of the city has really fantastic driving times. What would it cost to make the rest of the city as safe as this part of the city, and bring 192 second driving times to all of the citizens of the City of Toronto?
I think the first step is we'd have to look at either more stations or stations in different locations as part of it. It might be a combination of both, because it's not, it's having, you know, if you can't get the people to the call, then you need a different location to do it from. In some cases, unfortunately, in the fire world, when we look at today's city, if we could go back and make choices, we probably would have a lot of stations in different locations. But we need a station in, for example, by Sunnybrook Hospital. We've only got about one spot we can put it. That's all that's available. It's a real challenge. And our problem is sometimes as a city grows and gets denser, it's so difficult to find locations if the existing station location doesn't work. And that's why I call it the storefront approach, the need to work with developers and builders to look at a different model so we can have the station in the right location to get to the calls in the right amount of time to do the proper job. It's critical.
So is the rest of the city unsafe because it takes 75 seconds longer for firefighters to get the fires than the rest of the city?
And I'm not going to use better, faster. I just have to use your term and say this area is safer based on response times.
Okay.
Legally, that's okay to say that?
So we do have to wrap up shortly. Anyone who hasn't had a chance to ask a question would like to? Okay. I just want to actually thank you both very much. Thank you, Chief. Thank you, Deputy. Obviously, it was also short notice for these gentlemen, and I really appreciate us being able to have the guys at the top come and explain why they had to make this not-so-good, terrible decision. Now, before I let you go, though, I want to remind you what you can do. If you are able to come down, and it probably will be Tuesday, and do a deputation, I know they'll tell you it's 5 minutes, but it'll probably be 3 minutes. Please speak to my staff at the back. We will take names. If you decide to come down on Tuesday and want to speak, let me know. The budget chief has says that he will add people. It will be at the end of the list. The meetings start at 9:30 in the morning and go till 8 at night. So if you are on the list, it could be quite a long wait, but it's interesting to listen to other residents, their concerns as well. If you're not able to come down, we've got some information sheets you can pick up at the back, which will tell you the email address and remind you to put at the top on your email, please ask them to distribute to the mayor and all 44 councillors. Then you don't have to work out all the emails for everyone. The city clerks will do that for you. We've also got some hard copies of petitions. If you'd like to take a couple of copies and take them to your friends, your neighbors, either mail them to me by Friday, January the 11th. And I'm not sure if I'm allowed to do this, but I'm recommending if you can't come to me, drop them at one of our four fire stations in our ward. Am I allowed to do that? That's fine. On the piece of paper, we've given you the addresses of our fire stations, and I will go around over that weekend and pick up all the petitions. I know people like a petition online, but by golly, it looks so much more effective at council when I can go and hand this big petition of signatures in and say I have 10,000 signatures of keeping Runnymede Station open. That's what you can do to help me. Yes, it is 44 councillors and possibly a mayor in January who will be voting. So I need every councillor to hear from you. I need to find $2 million, or $1.89 million, rounded up for $2 million, to keep this station open. So I do need your help. I have gone to the media, as you've possibly seen. It's not Swansea, it is Runnymede. We apologize for the confusion. But they're all the same to us. They're all our local firefighters. Oh, one question I didn't ask, and no one asked. If the station closes, what will happen to our firefighters?
Yeah.
They're important. They're residents. They're people.
In today's service, we have 103 positions that are open right now for various reasons. So if council was to support the budget committee's proposal that we put forward, we would then make changes through the year. We wouldn't fill the 103. We would just move people. There's 104 fire staff affected. So no active firefighter would lose your job. There's no layoffs. What we do is they would fill existing vacancies. We'd move people around. There still is an impact, obviously, but the existing fire staff in the Runnymede station would be moved to other stations and other crews.
So I think that is important to know. They won't lose their jobs, but a lot of them are local, a lot of residents, a lot of firefighters in all of our stations, they walk to work. And I think that's nice, and then they know the community, and then they know where we're digging up roads and where we're not digging up roads. So I do want to thank you both very much for coming and explaining this terrible decision you have had to make. I want to thank you for your amazing questions, and I think we've shown we actually are supporting the whole city, not just our ward. And thank you for coming out at such short notice on a Sunday. And you know me, I don't call emergency meetings unless I think they're very, very important. So as I say, there's information at the back. If you haven't signed in, please sign in, because then we can also keep you informed of what's happening. And enjoy the rest of your Sunday.
Thank you.
Yeah. 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 Yeah.